So, welcome to you tonight. I'm very happy to be here with you and with Erik Swingedal, that is here in the first row. Erik Swingedal is a very interesting figure. That's why he has been invited tonight. And he's a geographer that tries to go beyond, let's say, the dichotomy nature and society. He tries to make of this a dialectic that can be helpful to understand a little bit the complexity of today. And he also has written against the separation of physical geography from social or human geography, an old fracture that he is trying to overcome and to transform in a different mindset. He's working for this with this scope on a political ecology in a way to fill, in fact, this gap between human and physical geography. So I want to welcome him in tonight. Why we are here tonight? In fact, this is the first session of a series of sessions that will be realized in this fall semester inside in the frame of the MIS new master in urban and territorial, postgraduate master in urban and territorial design that is starting this year here in Lausanne and will continue for the next semester in Zurich at the ETH. And I think probably that some of the colleagues of the ETH are also following us. So eventually, Milica, if you are there, I'm very pleased to start this session that will be continued also at the ETH. The sessions have been organized following three main topics. The first that we start tonight is this investigation of the critical investigation of the notion of the ecological transition. Now we are all reflecting and working on this notion, and we think it is important not to just assume it, but really to consider as a research question and a critical in need of a critical approach. What is very important for us is the role of design inside this critical investigation of the ecological transition. I mean, what would be the role of design? What would be the role of urban and territorial designer in this frame? The second group will be related to environmental history and theories, especially together with Sébastien Marot, and which seems very logical. You know, if we want to investigate the ecological transition, we also have to modify our gaze, our way to understand territories and to read the environmental histories that made the territories what they are today. The third group of sessions wants to understand the re-emerging of system thinking. So it's something that was very important, very present in the 50s and in the 60s. And today, this idea of systemic approach is really re-emerging or re-emerged, but in a different way. And although the numerous criticisms that at the time were constructed against this approach is again today a fundamental way to look at the environmental ecological processes. Is not possible not to escape from the idea of system and system thinking. Elena Cogato-Lanza, that is also here tonight, will also organize this sessions. To conclude, what we would like with these sessions is to create a moment of debate. So Erik Swingedal will have a make a lecture, but we hope that you will be present as a kind of active listeners and using his presence, also thanking him for being here physically and really make the best out of this presence. So now a few more words about Erik Swingedal. So he's a geographer, as I said. He's a professor at the University of Manchester. He's a member of the Manchester Urban Institute. Erik graduated both in agricultural engineering and urban and regional planning from Leuven. And he holds honorary doctorates from Malmö University in Sweden and Roskilde University in Denmark. He worked on a PhD thesis entitled The Production of New Spaces of Production that was completed under the supervision of David Harvey, so in the States, in 1991. Erik Swingedal also taught at the University of Oxford and Ghent in Belgium. His interest, as I said before, focused on political ecology issues, mainly related to water. He has written a lot about water in terms of political and ecological and political terms, transformation of nature and urban governance. The figure of the post-democratic city will be the leitmotif of its contribution, Promises of the Political Depoliticized Politics of Post-Democratic Urbanization. So I welcome Erik here and look forward to a nice discussion.
Thank you very much. Let me try to. Good evening. I hope the people at home can hear me. If not, put it in the chat, then the local people can adjust the volume or whatever needs to be done for the people here. It's a pleasure for the first time in almost a year and a half to be live again with a live public, with people I can see rather than these black little screens on a Zoom connection that I would get really, really annoyed with. So it's nice to be with live people in a live situation. I'm an urban political ecologist. That's what people usually call me, which indeed suggests that what I'm interested in is the intimate articulation between the human and the non-human in the construction of the built environment, in the making of built environments, in the making of cities. That's why I call myself an urban political ecology. Consider, for example, that mobile phones you undoubtedly all have in your pockets, because life in Lausanne would not be worth living without a mobile phone in your pocket, would it not? Now, do consider that each time you buy a mobile phone, you put a Kalashnikov in the hand of a black kid somewhere in Africa. And if you buy a new one because the operating system does not any longer work and you take it to the recycling center, as you probably do, you're ecologically minded, are you not? That these phones end up in the informal settlements of Mumbai or Dhaka to be dismantled in socio-ecologically dystopian environments, also often by kids. So that is the kind of urban political ecology that I'm interested in, how our everyday lives are deeply embedded in a combined but uneven socio-ecological catastrophe that is all in all structured by the process of planetary urbanization. But that's what I really do. But today I'm going to take a particular snapshot at the question of the political ecological. So for me, there is no difference between the ecological, the socio-ecological, and the built environment. So as David Harvey once says, there's nothing unnatural about New York City. But I'm interested here today in the question of the political. Because I would argue, A, that the city has always been the site, the arena, the terrain where political citizenship was enacted, performed, and fought over. Think of how any emancipatory struggle, whether it's the feminist struggle, the working class struggle, the African-American struggle, was always fought in and through the urban. how the urban is indeed, at least since the ancient Greeks, was the place of civic life, where citizens, as equal participants, excluding the slaves for the time being, but where citizens, as equal citizens, could participate in the making of their environment. I think today that is dead. And that will be what I'm going to try to explore. Why do we allow the city to become this depoliticized shell? In effect, Swiss cities are a good example of it. The quote that I start off with is from the great late Michel Foucault. And this quote captures very well what I try to convey. And if you think about this quote, for us Democrats, who does not believe in proper democratic institutions, and who does not believe that Switzerland is one of the great examples of democratic civic life? Think of the referenda and all the other ways in which you can participate in the making of your environments, right? As a collective, as a people. Of course, some people in Switzerland can't participate, but that's just an anecdote. So here, Foucault says something quite scandalous. He says, the people, and he means the people as a political category, is those who, refusing to be the population, disrupt the system. So this is the sort of overall idea that I want to explore. Okay, you have to think about it. But where is the machine that I should point at?
It should work now.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. So the title of my talk is The Promises of the Political. I'm going to suggest that perhaps the political is not completely moribund. That occasionally, perhaps, I'm not entirely sure about it, but occasionally perhaps we see it we can discern it in forms of urban acting, in forms of urban performativity. But that we have, oops. But I'm going to argue that over the past 20, 30 years, we can argue over how long this process has been going on, that we've seen an increasingly potent process of depoliticization, which I will define as post-politicization, and the increasing consolidation of what I and others have called post-democratic urbanization. I shall try to explain that later, what I mean by that. Much of this is based on a book that came out 2 years ago with MIT entitled The Promises of the Political. People want to know more about what I'm saying there that they can find. This is my advertisement, dear plug. I get a dollar for each book I sell. But you can get it for the online too if you know how to do it. Very often, of course, it is not academics, scholars like you and I, who have their finger on the pulse of life. We academics usually run hopelessly late in diagnosing the state of the situation. That's why I often return to novelists, movie makers, poets, etc., who much more often convey a sense of the spirit of the time. This is a quote from the late, great José Saramago, a Nobel Prize winning novelist, died 10 years ago or so. I'm sure most of you are familiar with this great novel, City of the Blind. Who is that, City of the Blind? Oh boy. Anyway, by the way, you probably have heard of Saramago. You've seen the movie, perhaps, City of the Blind. He wrote three urban novels. And the last one, the last novel in this trilogy, was set in the same town where a few years earlier, everyone has gone mysteriously blind except for one woman who could see through one eye. The book is called Essay on Lucidity. And it's a fantastic, devastating diagnosis of the state of the situation, particularly in cities of the global north. It narrates the story of the Democratic Festival. And you're all familiar with that. The novel opens up with the announcement that next Sunday, elections will be held. Citizens are going to be called to the polling stations to decide who will run the city and what kind of city will be built, rebuilt, reconstituted, and reconstructed over the next 4 or 5 years. And in the newspapers, it's full, the TV is discussing about the party of the left and the party of the center and the party of the right, and that they will gain 1% more, 1% less, etc. Big spiel, and of course, everyone who put himself up as a candidate are very anxiously awaiting the verdict of the sovereign people about their fate. And whether they will be able to implement, build their dreams for their citizens. And then Sunday comes for the great voting moment. It's a bad day, it rains, it's cold. In the morning, very few people show up at the polling stations. Very few. In the afternoon, a bit more people come. And then, yeah, the sun comes through and more people go to the polling stations. So those who are anxiously awaiting the verdict of the people say, oh, okay, the people are voting, are coming, are voting. And when the voting is finished, and the votes are counted, it turned out that 60% of the population has spoiled their ballot. Panic in the democratic city. How can we govern the city if 60% of those who voted decided to spoil their ballot, not to vote? Panic ensued. So the novel narrates. And the leaders of the city say, oh, we can't have that. We need to know what the people want. So they decided to reorganize. It reminded me of the European Union when it was trying to organize referendums for the constitution. And people voted no. The vote was redone a few weeks later until the right the result came out. So a new campaign was set for 3 weeks later. And people were told to go and vote. And indeed, 3 weeks later, it was a very sunny day, and the people came out in huge numbers to vote the second time around. And everyone was happy that evening the votes were counted. 80% has spoiled the ballot. Now, there must be something going on in that town. The elites of the city, the governors of the city, thought there must be some sort of conspiracy undermining the sacrosanct principles of democratic governing. There must be some sort of attack, organized attack. So they brought in, as they do, the secret services and the police, etc., to go and find out the culprits who had organized this boycott, this perversion of the democratic configuration. And they rounded up people and they put them in jail, they tortured them, etc. But they couldn't find the culprits. They couldn't find any leaders of the conspiracy against the democracy. And so the governors decided, well, we'll teach them a lesson. What are they going to do, the people, without us, the governors? So the governors decided to leave the city. To leave the people of the city to their own devices, expecting and hoping, assuming that soon the city would descend into anarchy without proper governing. And what happened? Nothing. The teachers continued teaching, the butchers continued butchering, the lawyers continued doing their useless stuff, the garbage men and women, the collected garbage life went on. Nothing happened. End of the novel. Fantastic novel. And this is a quote from this novel. Western democracies, as this Marco says, but only the political facades of economic power. A facade with columns, banners, endless debates about The second assignment, democracy. We live in an era where we can discuss everything. With one exception, democracy. She, apparently, she is there. A required dogma. Don't touch. Like a museum display. Elections have become the representation of an absurd comedy. Shameful. Where the participation of the citizens is very weak, in which the governments represent the political commissioners of economic power. That's quite an indictment. Huh? If I were to say that, I would, because I would be told it would be not objective, ideological, etc. But he's because this is a matter of I can say that. Now, here is Yorgo Agamben, Italian philosopher, who basically says the same thing in a different way as the philosopher, the theorist. He says, there is a shift from the model of the polis founded on the center, that is a public center, agora, invoking the ancient Greek idea of the agora as a place for democratic encounter, to a new metropolitan spatialization that is certainly invested in a process of depoliticization. So I'm sure that many of you have encountered over the years these notions of depoliticization, etc., that we're living in a time of depoliticization. But what is meant by that? What is meant by that in the particular context of today? And I would argue that depoliticization today takes the form of what some have called post-politicization. Post-politicization is, and I'll go back to its characteristics in a moment, but just to get some framing in the beginning, it's a generalized discourse and practice of consensual techno-managerial governance in post-democratic forms of governance within an overall and undisputed neoliberalizing order. Let me give you an example. Climate change, right? To take an ecological, environmental argument. Two things that climate change is a big issue that needs to be dealt with, and that design has a role to play in that. Does it matter? Should we take it seriously? Yeah, I think most people, there's now a widespread consensus shared by heterogeneous groups of people from a variety of ideological positions and stripes and colors, etc., that the climate change is a clear and present danger. And the concern about the climate has now been elevated to the dignity of a global public concern. To such an extent, in Manchester, my colleagues in architecture, they're all working on this sustainability bullshit. They're all of them. Yeah, sustainable houses, new technologies, new infrastructures. I bet you do too, don't you? Yeah. That is precisely what I mean by post-political consensus. Right, that through a series of techno-managerial adjustments, techno-managerial adjustments, some new institutions here and there, like the COP meeting we have in Glasgow soon, new instruments, new technologies, a Tesla here and there, yeah, that will at least help us to capture and to deal with the situation. Who believes that? After 20 years of sustainable design technologies and institutions, what has happened with the emission of greenhouse gases, except last year under the COVID pandemic? It has been going up massively, despite our concern. What do we try to achieve with our Teslas and our zero carbon houses? We want to achieve that civilization, society, as we know it, can continue a while longer, is it not? Our society! That is what is meant by techno-managerial consensual governance. Exemplified through the lens of sustainability, where sustainability is now aimed at sustaining particular lives in particular places, in particularly good environmental conditions. I live in Amsterdam. It's a damn good environmental city. It always lists very, very high on any indicator, together with Copenhagen and Stockholm, etc. But of course, it builds its sustainability on an ecological disaster in the early years. Hence my example of your mobile phones. The same is true for Tesla. Have you done the architecture of Tesla? That would be a good lab exercise. The architecture of Tesla, which I will go to the better there. Do the geography of it. Reconstruct the design of it. And what will you find immediately? Peasants dispossessed of their land, of their water, the Chile, massive pollution through the extractivism of lithium, again in Chile and other places, in order to make Lausanne carbon neutral. And therefore, what cannot be considered is to politicize the climate, the environment. That what does really need to happen? What kind of world city do we really need to inhabit if we really take this concern really seriously, rather than approach it as a design fantasy? Now, in this context of fairly cozy, consensual urban governance that we've seen certainly in the global north over the past 30 years or so, the combination of public and private assemblages that come together to construct new urban environments, like the beautiful library you have here, for example. I saw the names of the financiers. Yes, nicely put there. That's a beautiful illustration of a public-private partnership embedded in steel and concrete. That despite this sort of cozy consensus about the new urbanity that has been unfolding over the past 20, 30 years or so, this consensus is not all that cozy. Particularly since 2011 and beyond, we've seen an extraordinary proliferation of all manner of forms of discontent, of insurgencies. So I'm interested in urban insurgencies, of what I and others have called insurgent architects. They try to construct an urban architecture, lived architecture of a different kind than the hegemonic one. And I'm asking myself, are these urban insurgencies, are they signs, symptoms of forms of new politicizations? What I'm thinking about when I mention urban insurgencies, I think of the Arab Spring. And the Arab Spring was not in Egypt or in Cairo, right? It's urban. And Tunis, right? But 2013, Istanbul. Remember Istanbul? Yeah, remember what the issue was? The cutting down of 300 trees and Erdogan's idea of building a kind of traditional Islamic shopping mall on Tahrir Square, right? Yeah, what happened? After 3 weeks, 3 months, you had 500,000 people assembled on Taksim Square, demanding a new constituent organ, showing the deep inequalities and inequities embedded in the forms of Turkish Istanbul urban and wider governance. And what kind of people were there? Men and women, Christians and Muslims, old and young, mostly leftist. Gay and heterosexual and trans and cis and bi and everything else. Right. Very woke. Well, here are the picture of the indignados and Occupy. Zuccotti Park. Think of how we remember them as urban names. Barcelona, Athens, Madrid, New York, Chicago, LA, Santiago, Hong Kong. Now, recently. That is Manchester. Not always nice. This was the street I was living in. And here is Spain, Puerto del Sol, in Madrid, in 2014. Now, look at this picture. Any Spaniards here? One. It's a bit of a scandalous. It's a bit of a scandalous thing, that the slogan. Democracia real ya, in Spain. Spain, which has the longest dictatorship in Europe in the 20th century, who went through a remarkable process of democratization after the death of Franco. And here are a bunch of people who say, this is not democracy what we have. We want real democracy now. What are they talking about? What are they talking about? My argument is that their understanding of democracy is very different from how others think about democracy. Most people think of democracy as institutions, political parties, and then lobbies, and voting, yeah. The institutions and the procedures of urban government. That's, of course, only one part of the democratic. What does the democratic do? The presumption of equality of each and everyone who are speaking, being irrespective of the particular form of governing arrangements. When was the last time you were reminded of the fact that the democratic is about asserting the principle of equality, irrespective of social, cultural, sexual, and all the differences which are obviously there, or the inequalities which are obviously there, political equality, democratic equality is the presumption that we're all equal. That's what they were trying to express. And the money. That's an urban person. That's always been an urban person. I'm telling my students, many of whom are very ecologically minded, and many of them want to go to the Amazon to save the rainforest and the nice indigenous people living in the rainforest. Familiar with that? Yeah. People are dying, so suffering from the situation, all our fault. We have to go and help them. Bullshit, of course. Do it here. Switzerland is the place where to do it, right? Yeah. It's in Switzerland where everything comes together that organizes the extractivism that dispossesses the indigenous people from the Amazon and that cuts down the forest. Yeah. Do you want some of the lessons joining? Yeah. Oops. And it keeps going on. This is an example from Frankfurt, 2015, at the opening, on the occasion of the opening of a new grand building, a great embodiment of the power of the European Union, the European Central Bank, opened up, and again, a scandalous slogan emerged. Germany. That's Jewish communism. Whoa! Whoa! That's not a cozy democratic consensus here anymore, eh? France, the French at all, you can always count on the French. Yeah? You can always put a count on them. Good, yeah. Chile, the most recent, 2019, 2020. Great outburst of discontent, joining up again a range of people who said, we have enough of this. Yeah. Did it work in the case of Chile? They are writing a new constitution at this moment. How it will turn out, I don't know either, of course. Just to suggest with these slides what I mean by insurgent urbanists at work. These are insurgent urbanists, insurgent architects.
that do they constitute the environment in which they live. This is not the design from the Stoic texts. No. But you can't say they're not you're producing an environment, a geography. That's backwards. Oh, now I'm done doing something stupid. No. Oops! Help! I should point there. That's it. Yeah. I should point there. I'll go back to that. Yeah, that's it. That's it. We sussed it. So, after this introduction, I basically want to make four points. I go to four. So first I want to say a bit more about what I and others mean by post-democracy and the dynamics of depoliticization. Then I'll have to invoke some theory to put some foundation under this notion that I already suggested of the difference between politics as the instituted form of governing and the political as this assertion of equality manifested in these insurgent movements. But then say a bit more about insurgent democracy. To conclude by asking the question whether you can discern in some of those urban events the beginning of a new wave of democratization or not. Is it just a janitor body and people will just continue? That's what I'll conclude with. Post-politicization is a very unfortunate term. I did not invent it, I borrowed it from someone else. It is like postmodernism, also one of those awful, awful terms because of this notion of post. Yes, it seems to suggest once upon a time we were political, but now they're not any longer. That's not the meaning of post-politicization. Post-politicization is a particular form of depoliticizing things. And there are others. Jacques Rancière has written extensively on the other modalities of depoliticization. For example, what Jacques Rancière calls archive politics, that is very much at work these days. Now, we, the Swiss, are fine, cohesive, coherent. It's just those bloody foreigners who fuck us up. That's a form of depoliticization because it disavows and ignores, it silences the deep divisions and heterogeneities that cut through Swiss society by translating that into an us and them situation, whereby a sort of cohesive internal configuration is seen as superior and united. And that, of course, denies, ignores the radical heterogeneities and differences upon which democratic configurations constituted. The democratic configurations constitute upon radical difference. If we're all the same, we wouldn't need that thing. It's because we're all different. You know, what I want is not what you want. So what post-politicization does, and I'll illustrate this in a moment, it disavows or silences the internal split, radical heterogeneities that cut through the social and that often pits people against each other in their desire. I'm not Swiss. But if I was Swiss, let's assume for a moment, like I could be, not just accidentally Belgian.
But let's just assume that I'm Swiss. My dream of a good Switzerland, a good Zurich, and a good Lausanne would not be the dream of the bankers from Zurich or Switzerland. It's not. I can assure you that. Post politicization erases that. The pretend is not there. That we're all in this together. Oops. Yeah. So I'm now going to go to some of the characteristics of the form and tactics and strategies that the act of governing takes when the post a political condition. And when I go through my example, think about what you know about urban governance, making a city, the management of cities, or regions, or countries. So the dominant governing view is first predicated upon the continuous cultivation of what Jörg Agamben called the state of exception, an emergency situation, a crisis situation that requires immediate and urgent action. And they fall primarily around four themes. Let me illustrate it by the best possible example. In 2011, was it when the World Trade Center was attacked? What did Bush say, President Bush? Go shopping. Yeah, be Americans again. Go shopping. What did he mean? We'll take care of it. We'll take care of it. A few years later, the National Security Agency was set up. And we now know, thanks to the whistleblower who is in Moscow, what it did. But think of, in a more everyday way, how in 2013, 14, 15, in the height of the financial crisis, any Greeks here? You remember undoubtedly, right? You remember undoubtedly what happened then, right? Right? You fucked it up, huh? Yeah, it was your fault, huh? Lazy bastards, right? Right? Yeah, there was only one crisis situation, and only one solution was possible. Did you feel what it did in Greece? The only one technical solution that was possible? Austerity? Migration, the same thing. The horrors are coming. The horrors from Afghanistan now, they change from country to country. They're coming now from Afghanistan. Yeah. But don't worry. Yeah, we're already building the walls. We're already paying Erdogan to keep them there. Yeah. It's not funny. It's not funny. So that our life can continue. We're implicated in that. Or the environment too. Yeah, we all know that the environment is a serious issue. And now the elites say too, we're on our way to a solution. With the right investments, the Green New Deal, and the right design, etc., we can get out of the pickle so that you can continue to go on holiday in Spain next year and so on. COVID is a very good illustration too, actually. Very, very good illustration. So a permanent state of emergency, of course, suspends the normal procedures of democratic, agonistic, and counter debate. Expression of legitimate differences and the struggle over them. Secondly,
So there's a continuous economization of politics. That comes from Pierre Bourdieu, the great late French sociologist, who coined that term for the Italian. And by that he meant that only those public choices, politics is about making choices, this one rather than that one, but that only those public choices are considered to be legitimate, acceptable, and reasonable that fit in a market logic. I call it on Bill Gates' spreadsheet. All other choices are considered to be irrational, unreasonable, impossible. Let me give you an example of that. I grew up in Belgium in the post-war period. I went to school from the age of 3 until the age of 28. How much did I pay for my education? Nothing! Nothing! I was the first one in my family ever to go to university. But I paid nothing. In fact, the state was paying me. I got a handsome scholarship most of the time. Yeah. That was a public choice made after years and years of deep struggle, mainly by political agents for which I'm still grateful that they did it. How much are you paying here? I don't want to know. I don't want to know. In England, what?
It's about.
In England now, university students pay £9,000, €12,000 to go to university, give or take. If I tell my students, higher education should be free for those who can and want to go to higher education, they think I'm a dinosaur who's forgotten that the 20th century has gone for that. Can't even imagine anymore that you can make decisions that do not necessarily fit in a market logic, in a supply, demand, and price combination. While at the same time, Wendy Brown argued there is a depoliticization of the economic / ecological. For me, the economic and the ecological is, of course, the same. Everything economic is about appropriation of non-human stuff, its transformation of non-human stuff, and the distribution of that non-human stuff, like there's an airplane or orange juice, or whatever else you can think of. The mode of organizing that, the appropriation, the transformation, the socio-ecological, socio-metabolic transformation of stuff, from lithium to a lithium battery, the Tesla thing, and its distribution over the various segments of society, that cannot be disputed. If I say that the great unevenness in socio-ecological condition is primarily associated with the fact that nature, non-human nature, is privately owned. Every nook and cranny of the world is privately owned, right? And that is the basic problem. And that therefore, what we have to fight for is a commoning of the common conditions of life, like air, water, health, education. People think I'm a communist. In fact, I am. But if I say that, I lose all respectability, legitimacy, etc. So no political debate is possible over alternative ways of organizing what I call the production of nature, both human nature and our own nature. That is what is meant by the depoliticization of the economic. Yeah? You can have whatever you want as long as you pay for it. Provided you know how to get the bloody money to pay for it, yeah. Which means that you have to sell your bodies. Yeah. Let me tell you an anecdote. You have all heard about the energy situation in Europe. Energy, the prices are going up. very, very rapidly, to such an extent that it's very likely that in terms of the UK, Greece, the governments take special measures that might be case that poor people will not be able to afford their heating. Because gas prices, just look at that. Yesterday, I did a little experiment. I went on these online, these software packages where you can buy stocks and shares, like the big guy.
Yeah.
You can buy Tesla, Apple, or whatever. Yeah. I bought $200 worth, $200 worth of natural gas because you've seen the price of natural gas yesterday on the international markets. I bought $200 on my phone. 2 hours later, I had $280. I made 40% the profit in 2 hours. Who's going to pay for that? For my $80 the profit? I leave that to you to figure that one out. But it's interesting. Occasionally, you use yourself as a case study, as an experiment. It's easy to do. It took me half an hour to set it up, and 2 hours later, I've made $80 of the $200. I thought I was quite happy with myself, But I learned a lot too. And this configuration, this political configuration, is sustained, is legitimized by expert managers, by consultants, people like you, who are hired in by the municipality, the city, etc., to legitimize a particular set of things. Yeah, you and I are the lackeys of the king, so to speak. Now, this post-political governance regime is not authoritarian. In fact, you're invited to do whatever you want to do. It's not authoritarian. It's nominally democratic. In fact, it legitimizes itself by saying, we do it for you. That is in the interest of the population. It is for the population that is being done. It is to make you live. And to make you to continue to be able to live the way you want to live. That's what you want your governments to do, isn't it? That is what Roberto Esposito, another Italian, Italian philosopher calls an immunobiopolitics. That a governing arrangement now is such that it is geared at sealing off the population, sustaining its biological and social integrity by immunizing the body politic from harmful intruders like CO2, like migrants, like the coronavirus, yeah? Which has as a counter side to it what a Hillel Mendy called a thanatopolitics. Well, on the one hand, there's a politics of life that shields us from possible dangers and risks, etc., but at the same time produces death elsewhere. I'm going to soon get my third vaccination, yes, thanks to the Dutch immunobiopolitical state. But this is quite literally that. How many people are still waiting for that first vaccine? Again?
I'm not vaccinated.
Okay, that's still mine. Most of what I am, I'm happily vaccinated too. I think it should be obligatory. Okay. So there is immunobiological biopolitics at work. Migration is the classic, of course. So the migration policies are precisely legitimized to sustain and maintain integrity of the population by keeping danger out, and that leads to death. How many dead people are now lying on the bottom of the Mediterranean? My partner is Greek, and I spend a lot of time in the sun with Halkidiki, but the Greeks among them, yeah, they eat a lot of fish, Halkidiki, and the fish now has this kind of strange taste. See what I mean? And the forms of governing, are forms of what I always have called post-democratic, multi-scalar governance. Switzerland is not a member of the European Union, but it's a member of the Schengen zone, as far as I know. It has a free trade arrangement with the European Union. It follows most of the rules, not all of them. You get all the advantages, but none of the disadvantages. Fine, that's the Swiss. But they're organized. These multi-scalar forms of governing are organized along radically heterogeneous forms of institutional configuration. We can't indeed not say that the European Union is democratic. I vote for the European Parliament, but the power of the Parliament is negligible. Most power is held by an elected, unaccountable bureaucrat. And the same for our public private partnerships. When the university, this university together with the municipality, city of Lausanne, and the sponsors were trying to decide on this new library, who was entitled to participate in that? Who was heard? Who was excluded? Like the autocratic forms of urban governance. And you see very strongly in forms of urban governance, we did a huge project on masterpieces of that kind, you know, that were making and remaking the city, right? And who did it? Who did it? Who was involved? Who had a voice? And who did not? And how did the particular configuration of those that were included in the governance arrangements, which were not democratically accountable at all, shaped the future of the city? That is what is meant by autocratic forms of post-democratic governance beyond the state. These kind of strange private, non-private organizations that shape and reshape the urban. And most of the problems that are identified as problems, like climate change, like mobility, like poverty, etc., are argued to have to be dealt with through technical and managerial changes. Not through changes in the social ecological order, but through technology and management. I'll skip that. This argument so far is predicated upon a set of theoretical interventions over the past 30 years that fundamentally make a distinction between politics on the one hand and the political on the other. And I think it's really important for urban designers that they get a sense of the political configurations to which design gets done. And to become acutely aware of what the political or democratic is. Most of you think, when I'm talking to architects, it's always full of participation. No, let's participate. Oh. Yeah, and then we have a democratic organization. That's not nonsense, right? Democracy is about equality, not about participation. Do you participate? In Lausanne's environment, the schooling system, educational system, road system,
sewage system, water supply system?
No, you don't.
But when you build a building, then suddenly everyone has to come and sit at the table. I do not want to participate. I want egalitarian access for all in the city. And how that shapes it very foreign and function. I'm very happy to leave to the experts to then do it. So politics is about the act of governing. And that is all that is today when we talk about, think about, act, and other politics. It's seen as just about a form of governing. Today, often called governance, because not only state actors are involved in it, but all manner of illegitimate actors, as Ulrich Beck called them, or participating in public decision making. There are absolutely no democratic legitimacy or authority or representation. That has to be distinguished from the political. The political is the world that stands for the radical heterogeneity that cuts through any social order. Basically, that we all are different and that we disagree about things. And it's precisely that political condition of radical disagreement which inaugurated the idea of the democratic, which added equality, we're all equal in our particular views and ideas. And democratization, therefore, is always about asserting equality within the registers of urban governance. That's, of course, what all democratizing forces in the past have done. That means the proletarian struggle, the feminist struggle, a classic of its kind, African-American struggle, etc. And that it was this universal demand for equity and equality that permitted the rise of different identities. So very much against identity politics, obviously, the particularities of identity politics and the associated woke culture. That's exactly the opposite of constituting a democratic polity in which difference can really thrive. Identity politics about me, gay, me, woman, me, black, me, white, man, so on. That's a bit controversial, I won't talk about it later. So there are a range of political, philosophical theorists who have tried in a variety of ways to tease out that dialectic between the instituted order and the political as the means through which the instituted order is changed in a more democratizing way. So the democratic political then, that is the moment of assertion of equality, brings together a set of characteristics that might be occasionally good to think about it again. What is a democratic constellation? It assumes that the place of power is structurally vacant, that anyone and everyone can occupy the place of power. It presumes equality axiomatically, despite the various socio-economic, socio-cultural inequalities and differences that are readily acknowledged. Political equality assumes paradigmatically that we're equal, while we know it's empirically not true. Its foundation, as Etienne Balibar calls it, is the combination of equality and freedom, which he calls égalité.
It also assumes that there is no foundation to society. That is, you cannot legitimize what a good society is on the basis of God, science, nature, or whatever else. It's utterly contingent as the outcome of the interaction between equals. The political emerges symptomatically at a distance from the state, as Michel Abensur, French theorist, keeps on insisting. If you want a democratization, stay away from parliament or the municipal building. Politicization takes place at a distance from it, both metaphorically and materially, as these insurgent urbanists demonstrate. And it manifests itself, the democratic manifests itself as an event, as an act, as a performative bodily act. It's a performative bodily act, it's not in thought, not in discourse, not in symbolism, but in performative acting in public space. That's why you know when it's happening. Did you not feel with Taksim Square or Tahrir Square or in Greece or when immigrants say here, I am here, therefore I'm from here, that they do the name of equality? Don't you feel it? Yeah? Yeah. You know when it's happening. Because it unfolds in this performative bodily act that actually stages equality. My preferred example is Rosa Parks. Do you remember Rosa Parks, African-American activist, one of the great activists at the beginning of the civil rights movement? Most well known in 1956 when she put a black bum on the seat, on a white-only seat in a bus in Montgomery, Alabama. It was one of the founding events out of which the civil rights movement emerged. Performative acting of equality. Yeah, putting the black bum on the seat. That was the embodiment of racialization, urban racialization in urban public transport system. So to summarize this, the political, I understand, as the retroactively revealed moment of eruption. This is from politics. That opens up a procedure, back to Foucault now, right? The first wife. Opens a procedure that disrupts any given social spatial order. One that addresses a realm in the name of a contingent, axiomatic presumption of equality of each and everyone. This realm is the name of this wrong is a condition in which the presumption of equality is perverted through the institution of an oligarchic police order. So I'm absolutely convinced that the instituted municipal order of Lausanne is deeply racialized. Convinced of that. That treats different people in different ways. Right? That's wrong in terms of the principle of equality. Or they put refugees in concentration camps. I'm sure you have a few in Switzerland too. Concentration camps, they are in Greece, they do in Holland, the concentration camps. You have seen concentration camps in Europe for a long time. Now we see them with their own architecture and design. I saw it last year, a design exhibition where the student design architects had come up with new designs for refugee camps. Well intended, I think. Well intended in many, many ways. But I thought it was horrifying. Horrifying design. Further solidifying the proliferation of an architecture of concentration camps. The political arises then in the act of performatively staging equality, a procedure that simultaneously makes visible the norm of the given situation transgresses the fantasy of the big order. That is, oh, there's no alternative, you know, there's no alternative. You should not do that. It ignores it. So there is no big order. Is what people say, fuck you. It demands the impossible. It demands the impossible. And it inaugurates the possibility of a new ordering to emerge. So insurgent democracy, understood in that sense, is a democracy against the state. It's one that operates at a distance from the state. How would insurgent architectural design look like? Oops. It has no foundation in the place, logic, location, or subject. It is the emergence of a common subjectivation. You can choose whether to become a political subject or to remain an object of your life. It's your choice. To join up or not. It's not in the nature of bodies. It's a choice. Insurgent architecture is always specific. It's always concrete. It's always specific. It's always contextual. But it stands for the metaphorical condensation of the universal. When the principle of universal equality becomes etched in the particularity of the choreography in which it unfolds. So it revolves around the slogan emergence, intellection, spatializing equality, and performative acting. That's Jacques Rancière. The political is the performative acting. It's an interruption in the order of the sensible. That's what is common sense. We know that a lot of what is common sense is nonsensical. The political is about instituting a new common sense and making the existing common sense nonsensical. You know, again, to take the feminist, the history of feminist politics in the 19th century, if a woman would say man and women are equal, I'd say, what? There's no way to symbolize that at the time, with a few exceptions. No, if I were to say a man and women are unequal, I get banned, you know? As I should be, obviously. But that is change of common sense, right? And it operates, and that is the most important thing, it always operates in and through both the metaphorical and material production of its own speciality. It produces its own geography in a real concrete geographical sense. It's steel and concrete, so to speak. It's a design exercise of a particular time. I'm almost back. Okay, this is my final slide. So the question of the invitation I extend to you is to think through what is, or should you be concerned with the question of equality, the political, in thinking about urban configuration? Exactly. That's an invitation that I extend. Secondly, are there in these forms of insurgent urban acting, animated by insurgent urban architects, do we see in forms, possibilities, elements that point at new forms of politicization that transcend the depoliticization that has marked the past 20 or 30 years? And then the elements I want to conclude with. Every single one of these forms of urban acting are highly localized, highly specific, highly concrete, as I said, although they express forms of universality. How does that operate in a in a configuration in which urbanization has become, as Henri Lefebvre already put in the 1980s, planetary. Right. But you're in my life, everyday life in Amsterdam or Lausanne are connected to every nook and cranny of the world, right? So my clothes, my food, my internet, my friends, my job, etc. So in a context of planetary urbanization, where everything is connected with everything else, like in systems theory, so to speak. It's a huge system that you may have read about the collapse of Evergrande in China, the biggest developer, urban developer in China. No? Are you not interested in urban stuff? The biggest developer of China owns literally millions of houses, went bust. And it will undoubtedly have consequences for all sorts of things worldwide. So what is articulation, in other words, of these necessarily localized activities in a context of planetary urbanization? Secondly, I think the experience also invites us to revisit the political names of emancipatory struggle. If you look at the 19th, 20th century, and that had a major effect also on the built environment, emancipatory struggle was organized through a privileged subject, the working class, for the Marxist, leftist, woman, for feminists. So it was a privileged subject, the animator for the emancipatory change. I don't think that's any longer the case. This no privileged subject for emancipatory change. It probably never was. I wonder if anyone and everyone can become a politicizing subject. There was a particular means by which to achieve emancipation, egalitarian emancipation, that was political organization, the polity. Who believes in that still? The polity. Very few people do. So what are the new organizational forms that we should think to if we still believe that emancipation is possible? That egalitarian emancipation is possible, or should we relegate it to the dustbin of history? That's fine too, but let's shut up about it. Yeah, let's take the world as it is, do your design, and give up on that. But if you're concerned with questions of emancipation and equality, who's going to do it? How are you going to organize it? And what are we going to occupy? Yeah. What do we have to take control of? I think urban space is a good starting point. And thirdly, and perhaps most importantly, is that we have to begin to use the word equality again as a political signifier, as a political signifier, not as a social signifier. Yeah? We all know that the world is unequal. I know you know that too. And I'm sure that if you do an urban study, for design purposes, you look at the inequalities, the exclusions, etc., in the neighborhood where I sit in, but you are. Can you do an analysis? I can do such analysis blindfoldedly, right? Right? And does not need to be done. We know that. But you also have to accept that your designs are not changing that socio-ecological, that social inequality. That we need to foreground again the question of political equality and dare to articulate that rather than being stuck in a critique of social inequality and a critique of the givens of the situation. How does the more egalitarian urbanity look like? In the present context, in the 21st century, we don't have to go back to the 19th century utopians, not after them, but at least at least we need to try to prefigure again alongside those insurgent architects how a more inclusive, egalitarian, and ecologically sensible city actually looks like. I'll leave it with that. Thank you very much, Judy. I spoke for too long. I'm sorry about that. I'll go carry away.
Thank you very much. Probably there is question in the audience. Who would you want to address?
We don't have
the. Yeah. The microphone, otherwise, people are throwing those. Okay. I can't hear you.
Yeah, I'm very happy. It was really honest talk.
Thank you.
It was very sincere and good feeling. I have a chance to study the socialist book in the past 4 years, so I have been studying the creative model behind. So I would ask, like, what do we do? Because we know that there is a machine which is running, and it's based on economic growth.
Yes.
And we have like design, which is like victim of all that.
Yes.
And here we have like the phone, we have the nice lifestyle, we are going through issues from the cultural sphere.
Yeah.
Do you see starting something different in the sense where we have all economic competing with this growth?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And then, do you think that we put too much attention on the natural environment
yeah.
to resolve the ecological crisis?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of that, would you suggest people to also
mm-hmm.
working with people?
Mm-hmm.
And what is the place of this?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very good. Very good question. On the first one, I don't have an answer. Immediately, but what I do see is that there are many, many people out there who, in a variety of ways, are trying to construct alternative ways of doing, acting, and organizing. In fact, rarely have we seen so many people, both in the global north and global south, who, in a variety of ways, are experimenting with all sort of other ways of doing it, and who, in that experimentation, are trying to prefigure different possible futures. That's certainly one thing to do. Second thing to do is to indeed join up to become an insurgent urbanist. Yeah, join them, right? Thirdly, because I suspect that most of you are not gonna do that. That's my suspicion. I may be wrong, but that's my suspicion. So what I would then say, be intellectually honest. Dare to say what you stand for. Do not try to cover up your situation by keeping your soul green and white, recycling, biking, not flying that much anymore, etc., while still being fully immersed in this globe-based situation and loving. So you love it too much. I love it too. It's not an accusation. It's an invitation to lift the veil of the ideological life that we lead. We lead our lives ideologically. And we do not dare to really articulate what it is we really want. Which is enjoying life and its commodity form, basically. The deep insertion in the commodity form, the commodity spectacle. Yeah? And we dress this up very often by some superficial moral or ethical concern with the environment. Let me exemplify that. on climate change, I mean. Climate change is caused by greenhouse gas emissions, right? CO2, methane, etc. So what do we have to do? What do we have to do? Get rid of CO2 and methane, yeah? CO2 saving technologies, alternative energies, that's, you know, the system. That's not the bloody problem. The problem, as you know, is the production of CO2. The production of CO2 takes place through what? Through accumulation for accumulation's sake, growth for growth's sake, which is structured in and through the private ownership of nature. Yeah, that has to change. Everything else is a fantasy. A fantasy. And I think one should have the intellectual honesty to at least articulate around that struggle between the reality that we really know is there, this capitalist growth, private ownership, accumulation that produces both gigantic inequalities and ecological disaster. We know that, right? And our discursively expressed desire that we want to have a sustainable and just society cannot be squared. Cannot be squared. Better be the intellectuals that you aspire to be and take account of that. So that's the. Then your second question: are we not paying too much attention to nature? I think we should pay a lot of attention to nature, but I do think it's a real problematic issue. But yes, I do also agree that we deal with nature as a fetish. It's a classic example of the fetishization of nature, which is predicated upon maintaining a separation between the human and the non-human, something that worked 30 years, not just me, but many of my generation, 30 years to argue that this separation does not exist, that there is an intimate symbiosis that co-constitutes the human and the non-human in a symbiotic way, and that through that we change both external nature as our own nature. So yes, it's not therefore we should get away from the specialization of nature. And here my argument is that democratization is one of the alternative way, different ways to begin organizing a different socio-ecological constellation. And that on the basis of the following argument. Everyone who's ever really tried to engage in a democratic constitution, that's difficult, huh? That's extremely slow. Yeah. Nothing happens. Yeah. Everyone has to speak, except nothing happens. A democratically egalitarian configuration is an extraordinarily slow one. It would never be able to build a library like this one here. No, you need an authoritarian configuration, a quasi-authoritarian configuration to get that thing done. Or not possible. Right? Democracy is slow, complicated, and very little happens. That's in fact why, in contrast to received opinion that democracy and capitalism go hand in hand. Not at all. Not at all, of course. Yeah. Economic growth hates democracy. What is the most successful capitalist country today? Which is the most successful?
China.
Now, that's a great model of a democratic state, right? Which state was in the 18th century the most rapidly expanding? 18th century, the heartland of capitalism. In England. How many people could vote in England at the time? 400,000. So there is a tendency under capitalism for authoritarian control and management. That's what this post-political configuration is to a certain extent all about. It's not about democratic egalitarian inclusion. That's really, really difficult. That's really, really slow. You know, we would not have a Tesla, you know, with a democratic decision making on this thing. You know, we won't have it to begin with. right? Because I think the people from Chile might have some things to say about the battle system. That would be my answer.
Thank you. There is a question in the Zoom. Is Charles want to ask the question directly, or I would read? If not,
I think he can.
He wants?
He can speak.
Yeah. Charles, if you want to ask for.
I'm happy to.
I will just read if you prefer. Will the scene post a political?
Oh, he's there.
Oh, he's there. Okay. Can we hear?
No. Thank you. I'm sorry for this audio. Can you hear me?
I will look here just a second.
Yeah, you can.
Charles?
Yeah.
Okay,
can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm just going to read. Hi, everyone. Good evening. And thanks to Professor Swigenow for this energetic lecture. And actually, I'm very grateful that you pointed out this post-politicization from a post episode of today's politicization process. So I'm wondering, in your view, did you think that post-capitalized, post-politicization, as you mentioned, as a new form of today's fundamental social condition? If so, and where would you think to start, to insert, or to propose some inclusive common framework for the democratic society of today, since that you mentioned this deep politicization is very much based on significant electorians legitimization. So I'm wondering that what is your proposal that what we can do? Yeah, thank you.
Yes, I do argue that the process of post-politicization, that is the evacuation of political dispute and its replacement by techno-managerial consensual issues in these post-democratic public-private forms of governing under neoliberalism is increasingly dominant. I argue that, yes. It has been installed more and more over the past 20 or 30 years. Yes, not everywhere the same way, not everywhere the same deep way, but it's generally the process. But it's not a complete one. It's not one that goes uncontested. In fact, we see all forms of contestation of this post-democratic consensus. And the two forms of contestation of it. What is the new populism? Budapest, Hungary. To take an example, Trump and other sort of xeno-nationalist movements in France, etc., they are a clear expression of discontent. Like, I hate it when the liberal American elites talk about those idiots who vote for Trump. These are not idiots, they know who they're voting for. They know precisely what they're doing and why they're doing it. And they're often quite the right to do so, from a certain perspective. So that is clearly a particular form of resisting, undermining the neoliberal, cosmopolitan consensus. The one that we share, yeah, that's why we don't like these people. But it is obviously a form of revolt. It's one I do not like, obviously, but it's one that is getting increasingly more performative. This is undemocratic, inegalitarian, exclusive, etc. On the other hand, you have the kinds of things that I was talking about. That is, these urban insurgencies that operate under the universalizing category of equality. which points at universal inclusion, and which also undermine this kind of cozy post-democratic consensual order. So in that sense, these forms of urban insurgencies are forms of resistance and potential transformation. I see others of those, if I think of the environment slash climate situation, since a few years now, if I think of the XL pipeline movement in the United States, Extinction Rebellion, Greta Thunberg, Youth for Fridays. I haven't seen kids in the States for 50 years. My generation was a lot, I don't want to tell it, but my generation was the last one where kids, high school kids, took to the streets. Yeah, in 1968 and 1969, I took to the streets. Yeah, and that stopped. Happened again. I was so happy. I was so happy, 70-year-old kids in the street. I said, fuck that, I don't want to be educated this way any longer. Right? Again, these are forms that point at alternatives and forms of discontent. And consider how, I mean, youth for climate, that's sort of nice, everyone likes them, they're kids, you know, everyone loves Greta. But in the UK or the United States, if I think of Extinction Rebellion, the way in which the British state is trying to criminalize the movement, isolate them, jail them, read it in the newspaper. Look at the Guardian, what the British state is trying to do to stifle forms of radical or big peaceful discontent. Again, these are possible moments and strategies that undermine the post-democratic consensus. In France, the yellow vests are also a potential sort of idea, particularly at moments that I thought were very powerful, when yellow vests, they emerged as a reaction against increasing gasoline prices, but in many occasions they joined up with the Greens, yeah? Under the slogan "Faire du moi, faire du terre, même combat." End of the world, end of the month, same struggle. So again, these are forms of politics that hint at whether they're successful or not. I don't know. I'm just an academic, you know. To try to understand what is going on, who's interested in possible forms of politicization and then emancipate the sort of ways and how the urban functions in that.
Thank you. Actually, I've got a question also just about it. You talk about the movement of the Gilets Jaunes,
yeah,
which actually has come from the countryside more than the city, you know. What do you think about this possibility of the countryside or the rural space? Because you speak also about public space, but there is also public space in the rural side, quite often.
Yes, yes, of course, many of the issues and problems and discontents murmur in the countryside, in the rural area, a form of politicization. It's in Paris, it's in New York. The Gilets Jaunes, although coming from the politicizing performative act is in the city. It's an urban choreography. Totally ineffective to do it in a small village. No one pay any attention. So that's why I said in the very beginning, any politicizing struggle, even though the conditions might have to do with something that happens elsewhere, has to be metropolitan, has to be in the city. That's why if you want to save the Amazon, you do it in Zurich, not in the Amazon.
My question comes from this earlier discussion we had about the nature-culture dualism,
yes,
and the problem that it creates.
Yes.
In one of your readings, is this that environmental transformation is not independent of class, gender, ethnicity, etc.
Correct.
And as geographers and as urbanists, yes, one of the common tools is a map of different kinds and different genres. Is there or do you see a possibility of being able to translate these various issues,
yes,
into something that can be read on the territory in form of a map?
I understand what you mean. I'm a geographer. I've never made a map in my life.
Then
I studied planning. I did much more of this kind of mapping exercise. But it's a very good question. For which I don't have an easy answer. But I do have now a starting PhD student. He started this month, a guy from Chile, who's working on urbanism and extractivism. And his PhD will be on sacrifice zones, that is the urban environments that are produced and made up with the slack of the mines. So literally in the cities you have these heaps of mine residue. Which have now become part of the urban fabric. So it's a classic example of a socio-ecological class structure, ethnicity structure form of urbanization. He wants to do mapping too. And we try to think on how to do that. Standard maps do not work because maps have the great disadvantage that they're very static. So it has to be something that is a dynamic and it is lived. Maps are also the to be embodied to take the life out of stuff. But also, I'm not a specialist in visualization, mapping of that sort of. But there is good literature on doing that available. Good attempts on visualizing. In a variety of ways, among others, through new mapping techniques of those deep inequalities. And it's sometimes a matter of thinking creatively. In the 1960s, there was this geographer from Detroit. And one of the things he did, he did maps, that's all he did. So he had, for example, a map of the number of glass particles per square of a meter or so on the playgrounds of schools. That's a wonderful thing, yeah? Because that map, of course, perfectly fine with poverty. The playgrounds and schools in the African-American, poor African-American neighborhoods are much higher glass particles than the posh white upper middle class schools. So that is the sort of imaginative thinking. What do I want to measure and show and display? I always garbage. Garbage gives us a lot away. You know, do a mapping of garbage and you have a map of your city. Of the cultural, social, economic population of your city. Things like that, but that's the best I can do. But it would be a fantastic project to do so. And there is good stuff around that in a variety of ways is trying to get ground and make visible through a variety of mapping, photographic and other techniques, some of those elements.
Here we have another question.
First of all, thank you very much for the speech. I was wondering if you like mention a part of the speech that you have about like politics is the political.
Yeah.
And you also mentioned the fact that like the political is the one that is based on radical disagreement.
Yes.
And I was wondering in the same idea of liberal system.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, are we like facing a kind of voting system that is based on major and minor, and then like there is always the major that wins, and if then we say, for example, okay, that can be an experience for the people. For example, I give an example. If tomorrow is a referendum in a city that shall be legalized LGBTQ marriage, and the majority of the people come with the fact that no, we don't want it, shall we say, okay, it's a democracy, we shall trust.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very good question. Well, the point I'm trying to make is that the democratic has nothing to do with the majority. Zero. absolutely zero. It has to do with equality. Democracy as an instituted organ often has to do with majorities versus minorities. And that's fine. You have to, there needs to be some kind of institutional arrangement. But let's not confuse the two. The democratic is always the terrain of defining and fighting for equality. So your example, LGBTQ, is a very good one. It's a very good one, because as far as we know, it's a minority of the population. Yeah, most people are heterosexual, right? But there is a certain group of people who, for a variety of reasons, are LGBTQ+. In a democracy, they have nothing to say. Yeah, because they would always be a minority, right? Now, of course, when people like that are in a variety of ways discriminated, acted against, etc., a wrong is being done in the name of equality, right? So the democratic configuration is their inclusion at an equal base, just like everyone else. So, and here the parallels with the earlier totalitarian feminist movement that I've now made several times is perfect, right? And it's only through that, I think, that identity can be asserted. That is through universal egalitarian inclusion that one can actually exercise one's own bodily identity. And that goes very much against the sort of woke identity politics that's going on, this anti-universal, which I think is deeply problematic. This is about entitlements, not about universal egalitarian inclusion. And as Foucault said, the struggle for egalitarian inclusion has always been the struggle of a minority. At the height of the 19th and 20th century struggles for emancipation, not all workers were proletarians. A small percentage were proletarians that is fighting for egalitarian transformation. Not all women became feminists in the sense of fighting with their bodies for political equality. A tiny minority did, with massive consequences. In fact, still not perfect. Yes, it's not finished. I'm not saying that. So the point I'm trying to make is that the democratic political is always the realm of the few, of the minority, not of the majority, which puts it in contradistinction to democratic governing, where you indeed have these kind of majorities and minorities. But this is a question of institutional organization. And that matters. I'm not saying it doesn't matter, but it's not the alpha and the omega of how to think through equality and democratization, which is animated by few people. Most people, to be honest, most people don't care. They just want to live their lives. That could be recognized.
Thank you for your speech. That was very inspiring. I have a question. You said just before that democracy is very slow.
Yeah.
Do you think that global warming is to change the fast?
Yes. That's I hear this argument very often. Well, my argument is that we are running towards Armageddon with our eyes open. So the fact of the matter is, despite the fact that most of us do agree and do know how urgent the climate situation is, each time I listen to my physical geography specialist, my hair goes up, you know? It's frightening. It's absolutely frightening. When they speak to the public, they try to tone it down, not to scare people too much. The science, and I'm not a scientist in that sense, but the science is frightening. It's just frightening, right? And it is therefore urgent. Yes. What I do observe is that you don't do anything about it. Yeah? that we're actually making the situation worse by the day in terms of the totality of greenhouse gas emissions. And my argument is that the techno-managerial attempts to find techno-managerial solutions are actually contributing to making the problem worse. So if Tesla were neutral with respect to the climate, I wouldn't care. I think Tesla is positively negative. Yeah. So continuing what we're doing is a highway to Armageddon, and everything that we try to do with this configuration is actually make the situation worse. So then the question is, what do we do? Yeah, the question is, what do we do? And I do think we have to slow down the very fundamental mechanism upon which the environmental condition rests, which is growth for growth's sake, accumulation for accumulation's sake, etc. That has to stop. And to do that in an egalitarian way, given the massive sort of inequalities that are there, is not self-evident. And I do think that democratization is one of the possible ways towards that. Now, to come back slightly on the doom-laden scenario of climate change that I made, of course, climate change is not going to kill everyone. Yeah. It's not going to kill me and my kind. I'll be dead anyway. But my children, or grandchildren, are fine. They're really fine. Yeah. Yeah. Those who are doomed and already doomed and it's too late and living elsewhere, not in Lausanne or Zurich. Yeah. And that we do know that. We do know that the climate condition is combined and uneven. Yeah, that's why also we don't take it seriously, because you know that if you become part of the elites, as you already are, in fact, yeah, you can seal yourself off in this immuno-biopolitical kind of ecotopes, right? But which is predicated on, nonetheless, upon the already existing deaths of climate change and other ecological conditions. And that's my latest book that I'm trying to work on, is trying to argue that some of the fundamental arguments upon which the climate change consensus is built is fundamentally flawed, which is that climate change is a clear and present danger for humanity. Yeah? If we don't do anything about this, humanity, as we know it, will be in danger. That assumes, of course, that something like a humanity exists. Yeah, you can only save something, or something has to be saved, because it exists. Now, my argument is, humanity does not exist, has never existed, in the sense of the European sense of a shared, common, humanitarian world configuration. We're barbarians. They've been killing. Yeah. There are pockets of humanism here, there, and everywhere. Yeah, I'm not saying there aren't any. And I'm not saying that they are expanding here and there. But to say that there's humanity out there in this kind of humanitarian sense is nonsensical. It's a lie. It's a lie. Right? And we participate in that lie the whole time. Right? So it's a serious problem for some people. Much more than others. A few weeks ago, I was in Amsterdam at a round table discussion on climate change in the city. And I was asked as a social scientist, and next to me there was a hydraulic engineer, a water engineer, and the Dutch are fantastic water engineers, as you know, right? So I was trying to say that, okay, even for cities like Amsterdam, very affluent city, a nice city, a sustainable city, the climate change is an issue for Amsterdam too, given that Amsterdam is under the sea level, and with sea level rise, there might be serious problems coming over the next few decades. That's my point. My colleague engineer, water engineer next to me, he looked at me very nicely and very calmly, but expertly told me, He says, yes, that's the point. But he said, up to 6 meters, we can handle it. I thought it was beautiful. I thought absolutely beautiful. I believe him too, actually. Yeah. I believe him. That they can deal with 6 meter sea level rise. And Amsterdam will still be nice and beautiful and livable and sustainable and all the rest of it. For Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and some other places, it might not work in Singapore. But I think that has to be foregrounded. These deep inequalities that characterize humanity. The deep difference that cut through humanity, and take that into consideration in your own designs. Another meeting that I had with the Amsterdam city government, who were left in green, they're very nice, left green, trying to make Amsterdam as sustainable as possible. Amsterdam already had 25% of its energy from wind farms, and by 2030, they would increase that to 50%. Fantastic, of course. Well done. Although there's now a big issue that where they want to put those windmills, the people who live there don't want their windmills in their backyard. But that's a different story. So I went to the meeting about it and talking about these windmills, etc. And I raised my hand and I said, that's all nice, etc. But what are you going to do with your old windmills? Are they going to end up somewhere in India, yeah, for the recycling? And do you have any idea of the socio-ecological catastrophe of the production of windmills? They looked at me as if I came from another planet. Of course. So when you think next time about designing something climate neutral or CO2 saving or whatever, yeah, think out of the box of the thing that you're designing. Look at the life cycle. Yeah. Yeah. And I would challenge you to do a carbon save. I'm not saying it's impossible, but you will end up with something else. If you were to do the design of the life cycle, the production cycle, from the moment the plastic or the metal is extracted, and who doesn't really know, to when it gets installed, as part of a house or a building, et cetera. I'm always amazed when I see these fantastic plans by my colleague, architectural designers. I went to a presentation on a carbon neutral house. It's fantastic, of course. And it's fantastic. The technology is beautiful and the design is beautiful. I love it too, just like you love it, et cetera. And I raised my hand and said, have you considered the functions that go through that house, yeah, and the carbon budget of the functions that go through that house, people living there, food coming in, food coming out, cars coming out, children doing things, etc. Oh no, I've seen this thing in and of itself. I think it's ridiculous. That's not a carbon accounting. Yeah, that's carbon nonsense. Right? That's where systems theory again comes in. That house is connected. Every design is connected to millions of other things, right, which are not accounted for, but that can be done. It doesn't take a genius, you know, you have to make a few assumptions here and there, but you will come up, I would argue, with a completely different design configuration. Now, if you were to say, I want to do something in Lausanne, whatever it is, a piece of design, will you take into consideration what it does in Chile, or in Kathmandu, or whatever? And if you were to do so, how would it affect the way you design it? So most carbon accountancy methods, the statistics that we need, are based on territorial accounting. Every city, for example, counts its carbon footprint, yeah, how much it puts out. And that's true for stuff that you buy, cars, and stuff is the thing, right? But the thing is not the thing in itself. There's a flow, there's structures, there's almost no flow-based accounting of carbon. If you were to do a flow-based accounting, you get a completely different situation and configuration. And of course, the governors know that. Yeah, Manchester has a carbon plan, but has to exclude the airport. Because otherwise it doesn't hold water. The airport by definition is flow-based, obviously. So they exclude it. And then the numbers look okay. So these are ways with which you can actually think through the very materiality of design. Design is very material. It's just like making space in a material sense. Think of it. Insertion, the socio-ecological insertion of that stuff and the flows to which it becomes constituted, transformed, and embedded in the particular design. And one of my favorite statistics is China. And fantastic urbanization, right? The 20, 30 cities of more than 10 million inhabitants, the urbanization process in China is unprecedented. And many Starsky packs are putting buildings here and everywhere. Like, so China used between 2011 and 2014 as much concrete as water, sand, steel, stone, as much concrete as the United States in the whole of the 20th century. In three years, yeah? As much as the United States, who dumped a lot of concrete in the 20th century, like LA, New York, freeways, you name it, Chicago, blah, blah. In 3 years, as much as the United States. And then we talk about just the recycling and sustainable stone to wake up. Yeah. No wonder the sand has become a rare resource. Right. There's a scrambling going on for sand. That is what I mean by how distant ecologies get intimately intertwined with local urbanization. That is very rare. And it can be done. And I'm always surprised why it's not done, because I know you guys are not stupid. You know that too. Why don't you do it? Yeah. Why don't you do it?
Here we have a last
question. I'm interested in the permanent state of emergency.
I'm
interested in the permanent state of emergency.
Yeah.
And I would like to know your thoughts about activists now calling for a climate emergency declaration.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you. Yes. So, Extinction Rebellion and some of the other activist environmental groups have indeed called for declaring a state of emergency, given the emergency of the situation. I find this frightening. I disagree fundamentally, totally, and radically with this call for calling it a state of emergency. I know it's well meant. I like movements like that, but I am 65 years old. I've done a lot of thinking, and I do think that those people who do occasionally something wrong. Although I like that, yeah, and I want to tell them, don't do that. Yeah. Or at least think through what it is you're doing. You're asking for a state of emergency, a state of exception. What does that mean? What does that mean in political theory and practice if a country declares a state of emergency? That all constitutional rights are suspended. Yeah? The civil rights, constitutional rights, and democratic procedures are suspended in the name of emergency. I think it's the exact opposite of what we should achieve. Also because I think it is so much a state of emergency, although it's a state of emergency for some people. So I'd be very wary of that. And I do think that intellectuals like us, when they engage with activists like them, who can be intellectuals too, of course, that these kind of arguments are developed, because it's dangerous. And the thing is, we don't need a state of emergency. We already have continuous states of emergencies, refugees, crisis, environment, COVID, etc., but all sorts of are happening in the name of our happiness. And then I sometimes think, so no, I do not like that particular tactic.
Do you think that is because we lack imaginaries for how to do things for our
I think that is one of the great challenges. Is the absence of different social imaginaries. It's extraordinary. And even in architecture, design and planning, which historically was the great, you know, machine of a variety of kinds, including social spatial imaginaries. Today, they're completely absent. I'm exaggerating. They're almost completely absent. And we do know, of course, the vitally important role of imaginaries. Of the making of new and different collective imaginaries. Without that, nothing is possible. And now I may sound like an old man, but what strikes me with many of my students, they can't even imagine the possibility of doing things differently, of organizing a city, a place, socio-ecological, social-spatial, differently. They wouldn't know where to begin. And I think historically it's quite extraordinary that we live in a time with so few alternative radical imaginaries. And we know from history how vitally important radical imaginaries were in changing, transforming, feeding, nurturing, all sorts of new and different possibilities. Yes. And again, I think it's up to us, intellectuals, that is the people who just talk, you know, or write, or make pictures, is to think of different imaginaries and their actualization.
What is your personal opinion on this lack of new social imaginaries? Is it because we are living, especially in Europe and in Western society, in the world is actually quite okay and everything works perfectly fine? Yeah. We don't need to think of anything else?
To be honest, I don't know. I have racked my brain over this why. The question. It's not that they're this completely absent. It definitely is an element of powerlessness. I do definitely sense that lots of people feel powerless in changing anything. And that the only thing they can do is just continue living as they're living and making the best of what they can for their personal sort of life. And that, of course, does not invite the experimentation with alternative imaginaries. So the sense of powerlessness, which is again a symptom of the absence of democracy, you know, otherwise you would feel empowered if you thought you could do something. Most people feel completely powerless in the face of that does not help to nurture the development of different imaginaries, but to be honest, I don't know. I've been trying to look everywhere for it. I don't know, but I also think, and lately I've been reading a surge of answers to the questions about reading a lot of psychoanalysis in despair. Well, indeed, I think life today is structured in a particular sense of enjoyment, the centrality of a particular sort of enjoyment, the pursuit of enjoyment for enjoyment's sake. I think it's one of the defining cultural conditions of life today. If you're not enjoying yourself, something wrong with you. Yeah, there's something wrong with you. If you're not enjoying yourself, something wrong with you, it's your fucking fault too. Yeah. If you're unhappy or suffering, etc., it's your fucking fault, right? What you should do is go out there and enjoy what you're doing. Everything is there for you. Go and take it. It's yours. That's the cultural diplomas of neoliberalism. Of course, that is one that is always fundamentally fails. Enjoyment never satisfies. It's like smoking, yeah, or sex. You know, you have one day, next day, you won't forget. Enjoyment is always unsatisfactory, and therefore drives for more and more and more. And one gets caught in the circuit of pursuing always failing enjoyment. And I do think that sustains, to a certain extent, the cultural logic of neoliberalism. So one of the first things we should learn to do is to be dissatisfied, really dissatisfied, rather than to pursue, you know, our next thing that promises ultimate enjoyment, the next iPhone, you know, Tesla, etc. When you have it, it's not quite it, yeah. But Zizek and Coca-Cola, you know, it's not quite it. It's time to think. It's not quite it. You have to do the next thing, the next thing, the next thing. You probably think that getting a master's in urban planning and design here in Lausanne is it. When you have that, it will be fantastic. It will be, of course, it will be in 2 years' time. There'll be something else. There'll be something else. So you get caught in this libidinal circuit of always failing enjoyment that you nonetheless keep on seeking. I think that has to be cut through. And to structure therefore enjoyment around something else, not an iPhone, but better quality. You can structure it around equality too. That always fails too, obviously. It can never succeed, but it will lead to all sorts of different things one would do. So that is a sort of tentative answer, but ultimately I do not know, but it is quite quite interesting that most people would like something else. Nonetheless, they keep on doing what they're doing. And psychoanalysts call that fetishistic disavowal. Despite the fact we know very well what the situation is, we act as if we do not know. Right? We do know. We have the facts. We don't need more knowledge, actually, more data. We have plenty of data. We know, despite the fact that we know the facts, we act as if we do not know. That is fetishistic displacement. But that's what I see very often in academic and other circles. People speak a certain discourse, which they say is about the truth. They don't really believe in it themselves. You go to the pub, the cafe afterwards, say, well, I don't think that works. And he said, oh no, that's not working. But I can't say that. So I think dealing with that sort of situation, why it is that we do know that flying around is not good for the climate, right? I'm not good, huh? You do fly, don't you? I do too, right? Why? And I do think that it answers to that question, because as I suggested, it hinges around the way we structure our enjoyment. What do we enjoy? We really like it, flying. We really like it, although whether we then come in Spain or Greece or whatever, you go, damn too hot, the food is not that good, you know, I don't understand the people, etc. Yeah, it's not quite it, yeah. Nonetheless, we keep on doing it. So we are caught in the libidinal circuit of pursuing this kind of, the receding horizon of unfulfillable enjoyment. And I would argue that is the culture of neoliberalism. And that's where we are caught into. Now, we always talk about neoliberalism as privatization and the trade of the market, and et cetera, which is that too, of course, right? But its great success is in how it enabled to become embodied. Yeah. Whereas, I am your pleasure, take me. Yeah, that is what the world says. Huh? I am your pleasure, take me. We believe in the fantasy that the commodity spectacle will deliver our ultimate happiness and enjoyment. A new car, a new house. This is actual partner, great job, lots of money, whatever it might be. It never does. It never does. In fact, we're being caught up in this vicious circle of unfulfillable desire and dust is to make us even more caught up in it. And that's also why so many people feel depressed, uncertain, what to choose, which way to go, am I doing the right thing, am I enjoying the right way? So you feel a lot of anxiety. And I would argue this is the cultural embodiment of neoliberalism, and has now become, at least in the global north, almost complete to such an extent that it is not any longer easily possible to think, to fantasize out of that frame. That is not within the frame of the successive pursuit of this ephemeral impossibility of enjoyment offered by the promise of you can have whatever you want to have. You can be whatever you want to be. Yeah, that is the promise of neoliberalism. It only forbids two things. The culture of neoliberalism forbids only two things that I can think of. As A, being a pedophile and sexual preferences. Any sexual preference is fine, right? But not the kids. That's the book. Obviously not. Yeah? But any other form is fine. Any other form of individual expression is fine. Yeah? Be whoever you are. That one you can't. And being a communist is not allowed to write. That will also set you aside. Say, oh, I want a society organized by the common organization of common space, common advantage, that is commonly managed, which is being a commune. Yeah. But, oh! If I were to have said, I'm going to talk about communist urbanity in Switzerland for the 21st century. I'm not sure I got it there, but whether I would have been invited to come and talk. Yeah. I was looking, what the heck, you know? Yeah. It's something that becomes unspeakable, unthinkable. And when it's uttered, this kind of strange feeling of rejection, attraction, uncertainty, which makes me happy because still shows that the word communism has this possibility of unsettling. It's an unsettling world. It's still unsettling, yeah. If I say liberalism and neoliberalism, you know what? We'll fall asleep. Communism, woo!
So I don't know how neoliberal we are, but we really enjoyed that you took a plane for communism. It was really nice to have you, not in Zoom, but in presence. This is the first session physically, I mean, in this room also. It's the first time that there was a couple of us.
Yes. It's a real pleasure. It's my second. I was last week in Vienna, where I gave my first live seminar. And this is the second. Thank you very much for
having me. So really happy to have
you. I'm really speaking to people in the...
And I'm asking how to conclude this first session. And,
I wanted to continue the conversation.
Ah, okay.
unless you...
I'm very tired. I'm exhausted. And I need a smoke.
Okay, so maybe you're not answering, but I would like really to to continue this conversation again. No, first of all, I would like to thank you for being the first guest to start this series of discussion. And the question of the how difficult is in fact to speak of something that seems now natural, not the ecological transition. No? So how difficult and how ambiguous and contrasted are these terms, which however we have to try to go through, and this ambiguity is really something that you don't feel very well, not even that. And I think that especially for students and also for us, being designers. So designers, they have always to do with transformation.
Yes.
Which could be very, very positive.
Of course.
Transformation could be positive.
Absolutely.
But transformation could be also very, very negative, many absolutely. Failures, etc. But also transformation has normally to do with forms of power.
Also.
So we are in a way into this very difficult, although exciting in the sense that we understand that there is a lot to reframe, but it's a very difficult position because we are dealing with the institutions, you were saying.
Indeed.
and of course we can deal also without institutions, but nevertheless, at least I consider that there is still some possible roles for institutions, and that simply the idea of doing without
is not working.
We are really stuck into this kind of a mid position where you have to be with and you have to criticize at the same time. And I would like the students to really understand this
point,
we have at the same time to accompany and to be with and to be. I like it very much when you made reference to being intellectually honest.
Yeah.
Honesty, I mean, is the only possibility.
Indeed.
We have our limits, and maybe when we think to be honest, we are not really fundamentally honest, sure. But at least making your best to be honest. There is one point, if I can continue, in which I would like to not to criticize, but just to bring a little bit to your attention. You speak of the urban, no, as being the place for the political, and you, I sort of you use them, you put together metropolitan or let's say planetary urbanization as being depoliticized by chance. It's not part of this. I really think that you geographers, you have to start to understand what the city is today.
What is
the city?
Yeah.
City, the urban, what it is.
Yeah.
Because if we continue to imagine that your answer to Valentin's question about the gilets jaunes, so the yellow vest, but they needed to be in Paris.
Yeah.
Not so true.
Yeah.
Yes, they were in Paris for some occasion, but normally they were along roads, highways, in the middle of nothing.
Yeah.
Well, in the middle of their city, that's their city. Yeah. And I think that there is still a fundamental prejudice from the side of many intellectuals about the fact that the urban and the political is not only in the traditional
place. That's a very fair
point. That's my second point. Yeah. My third point, but I think this would need too much time and just to open the discussion. Since years now, I'm reflecting on this category of biopolitics and the biopolitical. And you made reference to Esposito and to Agamben.
Mm-hmm.
I prefer to make reference to Foucault. Mm-hmm. I think that nevertheless, it's denser.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the notion in itself is not neither good or bad. It's just particularly you say group of relations that you are putting at the fore. The relation between power, between life, and interest, but also Foucault interest, space.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And although I understand perfectly all the criticism towards certain forms of biopolitics,
I think that nevertheless, we are today in the need to take this category and to fight again on the biopolitical project, maybe a different one. And my question is to you, do you think it is possible to reflect in terms of a new biopolitical project?
Okay, thank you. With respect to the first comment, yes, being a designer is an impossible task. That's why I like talking to architects, designers, etc. Because in contrast to me, as a geographer, social scientist, I can happily sit in the domain of the discursive thought, etc., as I have done, and withdraw from the actual task of intervening in space and transforming space. You don't have that luxury. You don't have that luxury. Your whole being is transforming space. That's your mission. That's the alpha and the omega of what you're doing, and which is an impossible task for precisely the reasons you said. So on the one hand, I enjoy engaging with you precisely because you keep on bringing out your own impossibilities. That is the necessity of doing the impossible. But notwithstanding that, I do think that it, of course, always important to think thought in association with the practice of transformation. That's why I left the planning. I thought it was too difficult, you know, and became a theorist. Much easier. On the second thing, what is the urban? That's you say geographers should reconsider there is a cacophony of discussions in geography, not other disciplines do, of course, about what the urban is. And indeed, actually, dominant logic now, precisely in the context of planetary urbanization, which I've defined, is that of course, not any longer to do with centrality in the way in which it was stood in the 18th century, that it is everywhere, it's where people live, etc. I have a lot of sympathy for that. I can see the validity. I have many good colleagues and friends who have a very good friend in Canada, Roger Tile, who's been working for 20 years now on the suburban, however defined. Yeah, and also one of his own kind of diffuse concept, but the suburban as a political space. And thereby actively critiquing the notion of centrality. Now, I do plead guilty that I hold on to a notion of centrality. Whether that has to be the center of the city or the big cities is a different thing. But I think centrality, that is the coming together of people as a commons, is absolutely vital in a politicizing the procedure. And the geographical environment in that sense matters. I saw these fantastic images from the Taksim Square, during the Taksim Square, the protest in Istanbul, where hundreds of thousands of people were walking over the bridge of the Bosporus from the Asiatic part of Europe, et cetera, to Taksim Square. And I thought that was very telling for me. They live their life, not in the centrality. They live it whatever it is they do, nonetheless, they come together centrally. Whether it has to be in the center of the city again, I live in the middle. Sometimes it doesn't. I gave the example of the Exile Pipeline protest in the United States, which I thought was symbolically and materially quite important, etc. Was in the middle of nowhere, so, but had a certain significance precisely because of the coming together of all manner of heterogeneous groups around a common sort of political platform. That would be my answer to and of course the urban can never be really caught. But there is a big argument and debate over what constitutes urban. Yes?
Can I add something? I just want to add an information. The first invaders of the Taxicab were actually architecture students.
Okay, good. You see, it's social architects. Then I have to say, good, good. You see, can be done. And then the third issue on biopolitics. I fully agree with you. There's nothing inherently good about biopolitics in the street in the Foucauldian sense of the world. Well, I like the better esposito more than Avamba. Is that Esposito argues that this Foucauldian biopolitical arrangement has moved beyond that or further, hence his immuno-biopolitical configuration, which he immediately associates with what we call globalization, that is the demise of the state and the interconnectivity, which has led to a situation which most territorial government arrangements are now not just concerned primarily with the integrity of the population within the certain territory of the state, but biopolitics was all about the protection of a people against intruders, whether human or non-human intruders. That is, there's an increasing tendency of the biopolitical state to move towards a protective state that can be seen in the walls that are being built, but in all sorts of, and that I think, together with Esposito, is negative. It's negative. It reconfigures the biopolitical configuration, and it does so with distinct and, to my mind, dangerous geopolitical and other implications and consequences, because it's insiders versus outsiders, them and us. Etc. Whether that can be rescued, I don't know. I don't know.
Thank you very much. And we will have the pleasure to welcome our guest second time in the end of the cycle, in the beginning of December. So let's think about it, and we can also ask the same question maybe have some time to think about it. Many thanks for everyone, and also those in Zoom. And yeah, I think we can close and applause again.
Yes, yeah, stay away.
We have more water if you want.